football a little bit more than their first possession. It was three and out to begin with. The give is to Leroy Bradley around the right side, and he's out to the 25-yard line. That's a gain of four, and that's a win for the Rice offense.
That is a win. That's their goal on offense, to gain at least 4 and maybe 5 yards, because it gives them great situations where they can throw the ball for short yardage and also pick up 3 or 4 yards every single play in this option game.
Ball marked at the 25-yard line, where it's second down six.
This play goes nowhere. Tommy Hendricks makes the stop on Mike Gingrich. It's a loss of a couple.
Rich, the option offense can't have plays like that. They have to all be positive yards or 0 yards gained on the play. They can never give up yards.
Yardage under Ken Hatfield. You can see the rushing yardage. And Rice has made a pretty good living as a running team, as has Hatfield as a running coach throughout his career.
It's a very difficult offense to teach an option. There's only four teams in college football playing it right now.
On third down, Jamie Tyler is swallowed up at the 26-yard line.
Carrying by number 37, Jamie Taylor. Rob Renus led the defenders. James Hall assisted.
Rob Renus made the stop. And so far, it looks like the adjustments Michigan has made to this triple option have been effective ones.
They've been effective. I think David Lee, the offensive coordinator for Rice, he told us yesterday that he wanted to throw the ball more on first down. That's two drives right there. They haven't attempted a pass yet. I think they need to get Michigan off balance a little more to have a shot at winning this football game.
Travis Hale at his 11. Diallo Johnson at his 33. Flag down, a clip, a block in the back. This one's coming back. Adam Williams made the stop for Rice.
Those kind of penalties hurt your offense. Right there, Michigan could get the ball at midfield, but because of the block, they're minus 15 yards. That's 15 more yards Michigan offense has to go to score a touchdown.
And it wipes out a 19-yard return. Those were the types of mistakes that Michigan did not make last week in their win over Notre Dame.
Illegal block in the back during the return on the offense. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
And with that, we'll take a timeout. Rice and Michigan are scoreless.
How's it looking, Chief?
It's looking good, TJ. Real good.
So what's she dialing?
She's dialing 1-800-COLLECT. We're in good shape.
I think her friend's gonna dial zero.
Well, maybe she doesn't know 1-800-COLLECT can save a buck or two.
I'll rescue her.
Can't send a boy to do a man's job, son.
1-800-COLLECT, save a buck or two.
These were big last year, not last week. Today they already have a couple. Movement, flags.
Rich, this is exactly what Lloyd Carr was talking about. His team needs to focus. They can't have these penalties. They have to improve every week for them to have a shot of going through the Big Ten undefeated and winning a national championship. They can't have stupid penalties. It doesn't matter who they're playing.
Lloyd Carr talked about this Rice team is an opportunity for his football team to improve from week one to week two. So far, we haven't seen that improvement. Brady airs it out for Marcus Knight, who's there, but can't make the catch. And a nice job on the corner by Josh McMillan, the junior out of Richwood, Texas.
Rice is really putting their secondary on islands. They're coming up with 8 and 9 men fronts. And They're putting the corners have to play these wideouts man on man, and they're outmatched. They're better athletes at the University of Michigan than at Rice. But hey, it's working so far.
Brady on second down. Nice throw and catch by Walker at the 42-yard line. McMillan on the coverage. Not enough for the first down. And Michigan again is faced with a long third down.
It's a nice throw and catch by Brady there. The Rice's defense, they're really mixing it up, which is good, but they may give up a few big plays here with blitzing so much.
Mike DeBoard, the offensive coordinator of Michigan, told us against this defense, you have to be patient, but maybe take some shots. He's thrown long once. This time he gets it to Walker, who's got the first down. And he's down to the 37-yard line. Jason Hebert made the stop, a 20-yard pickup. Walker, the sophomore out of Syracuse.
Nice patience in the pocket, Rich, by Brady. He sat there and waited for his receiver to come open on a little crossing route. And then you see Walker make a nice play with the ball after he catches it.
Mike DeBoard, right smack dab in your living room. Thomas hit at the 35. The Owls have four or five guys on top of them. Wesley Kubish made the initial hit. Kubish, a surprise starter. Rashard Pittman normally starts at that linebacker spot. He has a sore knee, so Kubish gets the start today, and he's already made three tackles. Pitch to Thomas. Inside the 30, and he has the first down at the 26-yard line. Jason Hebert made the stop.
The front four of Michigan, if they play like they're capable, they should own the line of scrimmage against the Rice Owls. Here you'll see the offensive line make a nice seal, the fullback Shea make a nice block on Dawson, and Thomas makes a nice play, nice little run up for a lot of yards there.
Seven carries, 28 yards. He's already on pace to break that 32 carry mark. And he gets another. Bouncing outside. He's dropped. Travis Ortega made the stop.
Anthony Thomas. Jason Hebert on the stop.
Brandon, if Rice keeps playing defense like they have these first couple drives, it could be a long game for Michigan. Here, there's only four minutes, 53 seconds left in the first quarter, and there's no score. That's exactly what Rice wants in this ball game. They want to go to the fourth quarter just close to Michigan.
On second and 10, flags are down. Wolverines may have moved again.
Ball start prior to the snap on the offense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
This could be a long day for referee Steve Newman as well. Later on today on ESPN2, college football continues. South Carolina and Georgia. Lou Holtz looking for his first win as the Gamecock head coach. And then at 8 Eastern, number 23 Texas visits Rutgers. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, go.com. Play action, Brady, lots of time, and his throw caught and completes. Marcus Knight kept the feet in, and it looks like he has a first down.
Nice
Steve
throw.
Hutchinson lost his lid.
Nice throw and catch by Brady. But this is all as a result of the offensive line giving Brady all the time in the world to throw the football. Hutchinson and Backus on the left side. They've been starting three consecutive years. That's unheard of in college football. When you only have 4 years to play, here you say, look how tough he is. His helmet flies off and he's still blocking his guy.
Seminole Springs, Florida. Hutchinson, a two-time All-Big Ten pick. This is Thomas. He's down to the 12-yard line.
Anthony Thomas.
Jason Hebert, Wesley Kubish, along with Rashard Pittman on the stop.
Rice is really flying around on defense, giving Michigan a lot of different looks in the secondary. If they keep playing like this, like I said, it could be a long, long game for them.
One of the keys for Rice's defense to continue to play like this, though, is their offense possessing the football, which they have not done yet in two drives. Caught by Terrell, and he's down to the 8-yard line. Adrian Sadler on the coverage.
David Terrell. Adrian Sadler made the stop.
Terrell, who last year kind of lived in the shadow of Ty Streets, who had 67 catches, 8 catches against Notre Dame.
Ball at the 7, second down.
Down, the Wolverines must get to the Rice 4. Brady to the end zone, and Terrell runs out of room. 4th down and 3. Lloyd Carr went for 4th down on an earlier drive. Gino, it looks like he's going for it again.
Rich, it doesn't look like the Michigan offense is focused. They have 4 penalties against them early. And they're not on cue. The offensive line is doing a good job, but Brady's off. That's where penalties come into play in this game.
Check that. Jeff Del Verne has raced onto the field. The Wolverines took a while to make their minds up. Del Verne is on, and he'll attempt the field goal. He was 4 of 5 last week against Notre Dame. And he hits this one from 24 yards out. The junior who got a scholarship on Monday after his performance against the Fighting Irish. Michigan on the board, but maybe a moral victory for the Rice Owls. Dan Dawson deep. Epstein, who had knee surgery in early June, but still has a strong leg. Dawson. Across the 25 and out of bounds at the 26-yard line. Rice on top, or rather Michigan on top. Rice gets the ball next.
The House Badgers on top of Ball State by a count of 12-0. Over on ESPN, Pittsburgh and Penn State. Pittman Lions starting off a little sluggish on offense. Rashard Casey in there as quarterback. He'll roll out and find Mike Ceramelli. Touchdown, Nittany's up 7-0.
Rice keeps it on the ground.
37, Jamie Tyler.
Out to the 30-yard line. Jamie Tyler, the fullback. And it's a 3rd down. Only 18 yards for Rice right now. And Gino, this 3rd and 5 illustrates the importance of 1st and 10 to Rice.
It does, but I think with the yards, that's a big discrepancy in yards, but it's only 3-0. That's exactly the way Rice wants this ball game to be.
Richardson goes down in the arms of Josh Williams. He'll lose 5 yards.
This is exactly what the option does. They will not block everybody on the Michigan defensive line and let a guy come free. Richardson is trying to pitch off Williams, but he can't get rid of the ball because he penetrates so fast. That's why Michigan is a top 5 team in the country.
4th down, 26.
Size and speed, the difference right now for the Rice offense. Travis Hale again just got that one away. Diala Johnson at the 30-yard line. Slips one, but not two. Lost the ball, and I think Rice may have it. The Owls feel they have it. But the officials will say the ground caused the fumble. And as we know, Gino, the ground cannot cause a fumble.
The ground cannot. From up here, it looked like it was a fumble, though. This is just another mistake that Michigan's running. You never want the ball on the ground in a football game.
Oh, it's loose.
That ball
Gino
is out. That's a fumble. That's a fumble. Michigan got a big break, and Rice does not need Michigan to get any big breaks like they just got right there.
Drew Henson is in at quarterback for his first series. He has good mobility and a strong right arm and a man wide open. It's David Terrell. Terrell to the 30. And what a huge sequence for Rice, not getting the call on the fumble, and a big play of 34 yards as a result.
This is exactly what Lloyd Carr loves about Henson. He can get out of the pocket, he has great mobility, and he has a strong arm. You see a play fake to Thomas on the right side and a rollout. It's a nice pass. Nice pass to Terrell. He gets picks up some big yards off just a simple play action rollout.
Moments, first quarter. Our first look at the sophomore, Drew Henson. Thomas inside the 30.
Ball carried by Anthony Thomas.
Jason Hebert made the stop.
Bob Thompson on the stop along with Jason Hebert.
Joe Bob Thompson also in on the hit. Blinken, you missed it. The first quarter is done. Rice and Michigan from Michigan Stadium. The Wolverines on top. Now they missed that call. He was in midair when he lost it. Thomas on the reverse. Terrell. And Rice did a fine job of keeping Terrell outside the 20-yard line. Jarrett Irwin made the stop. Short of the first down.
Tackled by Hebert along with Irwin.
Drew Henson, the sophomore, is the wealthiest member of this Wolverine team. $2.5 million contract for the New York Yankees saw to that. Played baseball in the Florida State League this summer and played very well. He's a top infield prospect for the Yankees. Thomas inside the 20. He's got the first down for the Wolverines. And he's part of what Lloyd Carr says is not a platoon system. And there's not a controversy. Not yet. Henson had a very good year on the Yankee Farm Club. Last week, he got in against Notre Dame. The 13 home runs, that's what the Yankees really like about this kid. High School Baseball Player of the Year.
Henson's living every young kid's dream. He's playing pro baseball for the New York Yankees, one of the premier organizations in pro baseball, and he's quarterbacking the Michigan Wolverines. I mean, it doesn't really get any better than that, Rich.
He's hit his only pass, that 34-yarder, which has the Wolverines now inside the 20. The officials right now, I think, recess on the carry. Coming up today on ABC Sports, 3:30 Eastern, number 21 Notre Dame against number 16 Purdue. The California Golden Bears have a date in Lincoln with number 6 Nebraska, and number 19 Virginia will take on Clemson. Check your local listings for a game in your area. Thomas inside the 5. That's his 13th carry already, Gino. Lloyd Carr was explicit when he told us we don't want him up around the 30 to 32 carry mark like we had him against Notre Dame.
Maybe he's working him like a pitcher in baseball. Maybe he's got a rush count on him, and as soon as he hits 25, he's going to come out of the game, and we're going to look for Walter Cross. But you have to work your star players, and I think he is a star player for Michigan.
Henson straight ahead. Is he in? The Wolverines feel so. He made it. Henson makes one last lunge. But the Owls on second and goal have held.
There, they gave him a break, Rich, and let Henson run a quarterback sneak. This is where Michigan's size and power will come into effect every quarter this game goes on. And the longer the Rice defense is on the field and not their offense, they're going to get worn down by Michigan's size.
Third and goal. Henson again up, and is he over? Yes, touchdown.
6 points.
they stole the football. But Henson had it long enough for the score. Jeff Del Verne for the extra point. He made it just barely.
There you see the push by Michigan's offensive line and Henson just diving over to the top.
Michigan Stadium, where number 5 Michigan on top of Rice. Drew Henson sneaking in.
Diving over to the top. There you see the ball just comes out after he broke the plane. As soon as that ball breaks the plane, it's 6 points. It doesn't matter if it comes out after that. So that's why that's not a fumble right there.
Aiden Epstein with a low line drive. It's taken by Adrian Sadler. He's out to the 23-yard line. Let's head to the studios. Reese Davis.
Rich, last week we saw Sean Alexander, multi-dimensional. He can run it, he can catch it. Andrew Zau for Alabama against Houston, finding a wide-open Alexander. And Alexander will do the rest, taking it to the house, tied on top of Houston 7-0 about halfway through the first quarter. Meanwhile, West Virginia with all kinds of struggles with the Red Hawks of Miami, although Mark Bolger's thrown a touchdown pass to Anthony Green to give the Mountaineers the lead.
Lee Corso earlier on game day said Miami of Ohio would beat West Virginia. Right now the Rice Owls are just trying to move a football. Richardson trying to call a timeout. And he gets it just before the play clock expires. Richardson gives to his fullback Clint Leshburr. And he's hammered by Josh Williams.
Number 18, Clint Leshburr.
Rich, Coach Lee, the offensive coordinator for Rice, wanted to at least throw the ball a little bit more on first down. Every drive, he hasn't even attempted a pass. I think he has to make a pass because Michigan's size is so much of a factor in winning the line of scrimmage battle, and Rice can't win the line of scrimmage battle. So they have to look for misdirections and maybe throw the ball a little bit more.
David Lee, offensive coordinator. Second down and 10. Richardson will throw the ball and throw it quite well. Nice call, Coach Toretta. Rafael Tillman made the catch.
That was a nice throw by Richardson. They were very concerned with last week. They only completed 3 out of 15 passes. Nice little dive fake, pulls out. There you see the linebackers even bite on the fake. And Richardson make a nice throw to Tillman.
15 yards on the pickup. First and 10, and the Rice Owls have moved the sticks for the first time. On the outside, James Whitley makes the stop on Vincent Hawkins. Rice will rotate their halfbacks and their fullbacks in this triple option. They like to keep fresh legs behind Richardson.
One first down, that may start the ball rolling for this offense. They get 6-7 yards. On the first play there, that's exactly what the option offense wants to do, just like Don McPherson told us. They want at least 5 yards on first down.
A look at the option and the lanes for the end zone on second and 4. And even from that angle, that play just didn't work. Let's head back to the studio and Reese Davis.
West Virginia has never started 0-2 under Don Dalen. Looks as if Mark Bulger doesn't want them to now. Against Miami, Ohio, Bulger finding Torrey Ivey. Nice catch in the end zone. Second touchdown toss of the day for Bulger. Mountaineers on top of the Red Hawks.
Gino, we'll see West Virginia next week at Maryland.
And they do have one of the top quarterbacks, college quarterbacks in football right now, Mark Bulger.
David Lee trying to get this offense going. That was a big loss. It's third and eight. And Richardson going to throw. And again, he throws a strike, which is batted and tipped and intercepted. Dwayne Patman.
Rice only had 14 turnovers last year, Rich. Right now, with that turnover, they had six last week. This one makes seven. With an option offense, it's ball control, and you cannot turn the ball over to win a football game. Richardson throws a nice, accurate ball right to his receiver. Just hits his shoulder pads. Instead of catching it with his hands, the receiver let that ball get on top of him, hit his shoulder pads first, and just bounces right out.
Gilbert Okoronkwo, the wide receiver. And Patman with his first interception of the season. Henson back and throwing and incomplete. He was looking for David Terrell. Good coverage by Adrian Sadler.
I really like that play call by DeBoard right there. Anytime you get a change of possession, you have to look for the other team, if they're in good field position, to go for the throw. They're really going to go for a deep ball. That's a nice play call. Unfortunately, didn't work out for him.
Mike DeBoard right in your screen. Third year as the offensive coordinator. He had a pretty good first season as an offensive coordinator.
Not too shabby. National championship.
Anthony Thomas to the 45-yard line. It's a gain of maybe two. Brandon Green made the stop.
Rich, from the looks of it, it almost looks as Michigan was looking ahead of this ball game, because they should not only be ahead of this ball game 10-0. They had over 100 yards offense in the first quarter, and they only had 3 points to show for it. They have to start executing. They told us all week they were working on focusing. It doesn't look like they're focusing too hard right here.
Third down and long. Lots of time for Henson. He can scramble. Batted down. Incomplete.
Lloyd Carr loves Henson's mobility. Here you see it. He'll get out of the pocket. The bad thing with a young quarterback, he's only a sophomore. He tries to make this throw. Kenny Smith comes up and almost gets an interception right here. That's what a young quarterback, you learn. It's the process of becoming a great quarterback. You learn with throws like this. This is not a smart play by him.
Henson in a deep shotgun, which would look like a punting situation. And a little quick kick, a wobbly one, but a very effective one as it rolls out of bounds.
The quarterback for Michigan, quick punter for Michigan, and the third baseman for the Yankees.
Not bad. 10-0 Michigan. Second down and 12. Michigan's defense very solid today. Quarterback draw. Richardson steps out of trouble, out to the 7-yard line. Dehani Jones made the stop.
Rich, the thought now for Rice is they have to give their punters room to kick this football. If they get pinned any farther back, Michigan has a good shot of blocking the kick. So I'd like to see him throw the ball a little bit more. Richardson's been on the money with two throws today. Unfortunately, one got dropped, and it was an interception by Patton.
Gilbert Okoronkwo, a man that dropped the ball. Flags down. And if you're worried about field position, this won't help. First flag of the day against Rice. ESPN game plan back for another season of pay-per-view. Over 100 college games, all your favorite teams and conferences from around the country. Call DirecTV, the Dish Network, or your local cable operator. Third down, 12 for the triple option Rice Owls, and they'll keep it straight ahead. Just a couple yards for Clint Leshburr, the senior fullback out of Thorndale, Texas.
I think that drive shows why the option is only run by four teams in college football. If you don't have the personnel and the size up front to dominate a defensive line, you cannot work all your keys. Richardson, he's riding the fullback down, then they're leaving the guy always unblocked. But Michigan is so fast and so big, they're getting in before Richardson could even make a pitch.
Travis Hale backed up. The Wolverines don't come after it. It's a short kick to Diallo Johnson. It is 44, and Johnson inside the 30, down to the 28-yard line. Let's talk option with Don McPherson. Don?
Rich, the key to option football is reach, ride, and decide. Richardson has to reach for his back, ride him to the line of scrimmage, and make a decision. He has to decide to give the ball before he crosses this front leg. He's watching the defense the whole time. If the tackle vacates, he gives it. If the tackle stays in the hole, he pulls the ball.
Do we have to pay Mike Tirico for this?
He wants more money.
What do you know? Get out of here. I'm trying to watch a game. Get away from me.
Tirico, a recent resident of Ann Arbor. Henson, a lot of room. And he's run out by Dan Dawson.
Dan Dawson.
We'll bring up second down. Let's talk quarterbacks. What do you think of this situation, Gino Toretta? This is not a platoon. It's a competition, Lloyd Carr says.
It's a competition, and I think he's going to make the decision after the third football game. Whoever plays better between Henson and you see Brady right there is going to be the starter for the Big Ten Conference games for Michigan.
Next week, Michigan and Syracuse. Anthony Thomas. Short of the first down. It'll be third down and short. We head to the studios, Reese.
Well, Pittsburgh is putting up quite a fight in Happy Valley, Rich. Panthers on the move. John Terman firing to Antonio Bryant at 84 yards receiving last week and picking up there. Pittsburgh tied up the Nittany Lions about halfway through the second.
That's a very emotional rivalry, Penn State and Pitt.
Rich, as a quarterback, all you want is to be in a position to compete and win the job. And I think both of these guys are competing and doing the best they can. And let Lloyd Carr make the decision who's going to start the rest of the season.
Henson, the throw is dropped. It'll be fourth down and short. And another decision for Lloyd Carr. He'll send the field goal unit on.
I think even that play by Henson shows his inexperience. He's only a sophomore. He's in the pocket. He's got all the time in the world to throw. His guy comes open. He's only 2 yards away from him. He's throwing like it's a 15-yard out. Bounces right off his pads. He's got to take a little bit of steam off those balls.
Jeff Delburn from 38 yards. He hit a 24-yard earlier today. This one just makes it. So Delvern is earning that scholarship. And Michigan is on top of Rice. Dan Dawson awaiting this Hayden Epstein kick. Epstein had knee surgery in early June. Lloyd Carr did not think he'd have him for the football season, but he surprised everyone. And practice started by doing that, keeping it deep. Dawson will put a knee down. We talked about the two quarterback system at Michigan. Drew Henson is the youngster, but when you listen to him talk about it, he seems rather experienced at this.
I respect Tom tremendously. He's above anything. He's my teammate, and I think we have a good working relationship. We may not be the best of friends, but we have a tremendous amount of respect for each other. And when he's in the game, I'm definitely pulling for him, and I think it's the same when I'm in the game.
Lloyd Carr talked about this situation between Drew Henson and Tom Brady, and he likened it to a situation that Don James had at the University of Washington in the late 80s, early 90s, with Mark Brunell and Billy Joe Hogan, both who are starting in the NFL right now. A little reverse look, and that play goes nowhere. Now, Gino, in college football right now, there are a lot of two quarterback teams going. And there are, I mean, you go from Penn State to Nebraska to UCLA, Ohio State. But when you ask Lloyd Carr about it, he says, you know what, we're not like these schools. This is not a platoon. This is a competition. At Washington, when Mark Brunell was hurt, Billy Joe Hobert came on and led that team to a national championship and beat this Michigan team in the Rose Bowl. That's the situation that Carr likens this to, not the others in college football. Richardson out to the 24-yard line. Chad Richardson with the carry. Even recent years. And Ohio State with Jackson and Jermaine had a lot of success a couple years ago. Did you ever play in a two quarterback system like that?
Never. It was at Miami, you were the clear cut starter going into the season. But I think the competition in the spring and the fall practices for Michigan between Henson and Brady was very close. And I think Lloyd Carr wanted to get game time experience. Whoever plays better in the game will be the starter.
Third down. Richardson caught from behind, and again it's Josh Williams, who's made a bundle of plays already this afternoon. Williams has been everywhere.
Rich, that play shows how Richardson is really not comfortable throwing the football. He's more comfortable running the option. He had great protection and a lot of time to throw the football, but he got nervous feet and tried to run out of there and get the first down instead of just sitting in the pocket and using his arm to get the first down.
Ken Hatfield told us that Richardson would play the entire game. Last week he used Jeremy Bates, and there was a thought that maybe he would use Corey Evans. But if the Rice offense continues to struggle, I wouldn't be surprised to see Bates. Johnson at the 35. Diala Johnson into Rice territory. And down to the 32, there's a flag down at the Rice 43-yard line. 28 yards on the return. Travis Hale, the punter, made the stop.
We've been talking about size and speed on offense and defense, but it really comes into play also on special teams, as it showed right there with Michigan making a nice return.
Ken Hatfield trying to rally the troops right now.
Holding on the receiving team. During the return, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
It'll bring the football back to the Michigan 47. Coming up tonight on ABC, more regional coverage at 8 Eastern. Number 13, UCLA visiting number 14, Ohio State. Number 10, Georgia Tech takes on Florida State. Check your local listings for the game in your area. The Wolverines right now, number 5. And feeling pretty good about it. Drew Henson playing the second quarter and playing well. Swings it out. And it's caught by Walter Cross. There's been a Walter Cross sighting. Didn't see him against Notre Dame. Lloyd Carr did not want to play any of his young players in that matchup, but the youngsters are starting to get some reps here.
I think talking with the fullback, Shea, yesterday, Thomas nor Shea wanted to come out of the Notre Dame game. And how can you blame them when you're having such a physical ball game? You want your team to win. You want to do everything you can to win that football game. You want to be in.
Cross gets another touch. And on second and short, he's got the first down. Jason Hebert made the stop.
Rich, I think a big reason why Cross didn't play is not the fact of running the football. All these running backs on Michigan teams are great athletes. He is more concerned of protecting his quarterbacks in passing situation. The blocker has to be an all-around back here. He has to block for the quarterback, and that was his concern, not running with the football.
Cross on a draw. And he's inside the 35, a gain of 7. I think it goes for all the positions, Gino, not just the tailback spot. Against Notre Dame, Lloyd Carr said, we had to go with our veterans. It was such a big game. We can't afford to do that once we get into the Big Ten. We must be able to use our depth as an advantage.
Right. Experience is the key to winning football games and to having your program be a national championship contender. And that's what Michigan has. They have depth, and they have a wonderful experience.
across, breaks the first tackle by Lee Bear, and gets down to the 33-yard line. Very close to a first down.
Johnson on the stop, along with Brandon Green.
13-0 Michigan lead over the Wolverines. Yesterday's meetings were punctuated by a visit from Bo Schembechler, who burst through the door, saw the two quarterbacks, wanted to talk about running the football. Not a surprise from Bo, down to the 32-yard line, and he would be proud of this Michigan ground attack so far today.
He would. I think Bo even told us how difficult it is to defend the option. Michigan's done a wonderful job doing it today. There you see Bo, 20 years here, and I don't think, you know, the record that he put up is just impeccable, Rich. I think, you know, all the great players that came out of here, you're looking at Anthony Carter, Desmond Howard, Elvis Gerbach, Todd Collins. I mean, this is a great program, and it will be for years to come.
And he still is very much a presence on this campus, because just about every building is named after him, and rightfully so. Let's go back to the studios. Reese Davis. Reese?
Well, Rich, coming up on the Buick Halftime Report, we'll go down to Happy Valley, where Pittsburgh is giving Penn State all kinds of fits. In addition to that, how Drew Brees is going to weather the stormy winds coming his way soon. And Georgia Tech's little big man, will he be able to finish finally against the Seminoles? All of that coming up on the Buick Halftime Report in just a couple of minutes.
Thanks, Reese. Drew Henson still in. That one is caught. Tumbling catch by David Terrell. Nope, he dropped it. Adrian Sadler made the play. Terrell tumbling over the ball and then losing it.
Adrian Sadler defending.
On the throw from Henson.
Nice throw on the slant by Henson. Rice brings pressure. Cross steps up, makes a nice block, gives him time to throw. Can't throw the ball any better than that, Rich.
Henson has looked sharp. Tom Brady looked sharp as well. He had some balls that he threw as well that were right on the mark. Marquise Walker to the 13-yard line. Travis Ortega made the stop. 17 yards on the pickup.
Nice play by Walker, fighting and scratching for all the yards he can after the catch.
And Michigan, without a huddle, has forced Rice to burn a timeout. Timeout on the field, Michigan. On top of Rice. Play calling, you see David Lee, their offensive coordinator.
Well, depending on field position, if they get closer to midfield, maybe they'll start throwing the football a little more, but they're a running football team, and they're gonna run the ball and try to score on the ground.
Richardson again, the keeper. Across the 30. Michigan's gonna call a timeout, and the Wolverines want the ball back.
Hall along with Donnie Jones at the stop.
So the Wolverines feel there's more football to be played in this first half. We'll step away as well. Michigan on top of Rice, 20-0. Like that. Flags are down. Richardson recovered it.
Richardson covered the loose ball. Donnie Jones led the defenders.
Not a happy coach.
Offside, defense. 5 yards from the previous spot, remains second down. Timeout, Michigan. They're second.
But Ken Hatfield a little bit happier after he picks up 5 yards. Hope you'll stick with us for our Buick Halftime Report. Reese Davis, Rodney Gilmore, and John Makovic. We'll take a look at everything going on in college football, preview the big games tonight.
Rich, I think Rice has let a few opportunities slip through their hands, but I think you have to go back and look at the fumble, not called a fumble. That is big. Field position for an option football team is bigger than a passing team, because Michigan can go out and throw a 20-yard completion. Rice probably can't do that. So that's why field position is so important.
It was a fumble early in the game. Michigan had a 3-0 lead. It would have given Rice the football at the Michigan 30. Immediately following the play, Michigan hit a long pass and was off to the races, and now it's 20-0. Look at the yardage right now. Heavily favored, obviously, to Michigan.
It was essentially a net 60-yard negative play for Rice from getting the ball at the Michigan 30 to giving up the long pass and then knocking on the door at their own 30.
Michigan has a timeout left, though the offsides cost them a down. Second and two. Straight ahead goes Jamie Tyler.
Ball carried by Jamie Tyler.
And here's Michigan's final timeout.
James Hall.
Full house again. 24 of the last 25 years, Michigan has led in attendance. This, the 150th consecutive game. Last week was the all-time record, over 111,000. They definitely fill this place up. There is absolutely no wasted space in the stadium. There's only one way to get into the stadium from the ground level, and it's the tunnel that is right behind the Rice bench. They don't mess around here.
Short of the first down by less than a foot.
1975, the last time they failed to get over the 100,000 mark, was against the Indiana Hoosiers. 93,857. Few empty seats. Difficult to see the opposite goal line from that corner.
Those would be the Bob Uecker seats.
Yes. Donnie Mack has been wandering around up there throughout the ball game. Built this place in 1925 at a cost of $950,000. When it first opened, it was 72,000 seats. They enlarged this place, Gino, before the season even ended.
Today in the second quarter,
back when they opened it. They went, I think, up to 85,000 that year. They said, you know, we can sell more tickets. Let's put in more seats.
They have tremendous support up here in the Michigan Ann Arbor area. It is just a great sight to see, not only in college football, but for the University of Michigan.
ABC College Football Today in full force, number 21. That's a Hurricane picking a Seminole. How about that? Jamie Tyler's got the first down. James Whitley made the stop, and Michigan is unable to stop the clock from here on out.
James Whitley made the stop along with Larry Foote. There's a first down for Rice.
Our Buick halftime report is coming up with Reese, Rodney, and the coach, John McAvin. I'm sure John McAvin saw this triple option attack a few times for Rice. Richardson. The pitch. And Anthony Griffin. Out of bounds right at midfield and hit hard.
Tommy Hendricks.
James Hall made the stop.
Nice hit by Hall. See Richardson make the late pitch down on the sidelines. This is very dangerous to spin back towards the field when you're on the sidelines. That's times when you get hurt like that with pursuit of Michigan and the speed by the linebacking corps.
Second down short. It was a pickup of 9. Stopped with the play going out of bounds. Richardson swallowed up. He may have been touched by every one of the Wolverines rushing. It looked like a three-man rush.
Michigan put good pressure on Richardson there. That's where the size and strength of Michigan, as this game goes on, it's going to be more and more of a factor.
I'm surprised, you know, Gino, I'm surprised Rice doesn't just take a timeout and just try to throw it in the end zone.
I would definitely. I mean, they haven't been able to score or get down there. They're almost at midfield. Take a shot.
Number five, Michigan, comfortably on top of Rice. A 20-0 ball game. Bring on halftime. And Reese Davis. Reese.
All right, Rich, thanks a lot. John McAvick, Rod Gilmore joining me. And guys, 20-0, Michigan in control now. Got a break on that fumble call.
The numbers, as you would expect, dominated by Michigan in the first half.
And the biggest stat right there, Rich, their goal was 5 yards on first down, and Rice is only averaging 2.7. You can't win a football game running the option offense, only averaging 2.7 yards on first down. It limits your offense, limits your offensive situations of what you can do, whether throwing the football or running short runs.
The passing yardage, 164 for Michigan, split between Tom Brady, 89 yards, and Drew Henson, 75 yards. Geno, who plays in the second half?
I think you have to go back to Brady. That's exactly what Carr did. Brady started. Henson came in the second quarter. Brady's going to come in third, and I believe Henson will play the fourth.
Let's go down below quickly. Don McPherson.
Rich, I talked to a very pensive Coach Hatfield who said they have to run option football. The defense is playing well, but he really wants his option game to pick up the pace. On the other side of the ball, Coach Carr wants to cut down the mistakes on special teams, and he wants to dominate up front. He really wants his team to run the football. He said he made some blocking adjustments up front. They're going to run the football in the second half.
Thanks, John. Ronald Bellamy is deep. The Rice Owls finally get to kick a ball off. Bellamy a yard deep to the 23-yard line. Gino Toretta, there was a turning point in this football game. 3-0 Michigan on top. Diallo Johnson returning a punt at his own 30. Michigan got a huge break.
Huge break. Not only because of the not getting the ball, Rice not getting the ball, but that's field position for an option football team.
And then Drew Henson took over, sneaking it in from a yard and then hitting David Terrell from 14 yards out. And that's how Michigan stretched their lead to 20-0. And the Rice Owls will watch Tom Brady take the snap, and he'll give it to Anthony Thomas. So Thomas is back in. He had 15 carries in the first half. Brady's numbers, very solid.
But as we listen to Don McPherson, Louis Carr wants to establish the line of scrimmage. Look for him to run the football. Have his first team offensive line go out, run the ball, get a score, and maybe come out of the ball game.
Thomas behind Shea. Brady for Thomas. To the 28-yard line. It'll bring up third down and about five. Dan Dawson made the stop.
The Rice secondary is playing a pretty good ball game. But when you give a Division I college quarterback at a major university like Michigan all the time in the world to throw like that, he's going to find someone open. The zones are going to break down at some point in time. They're just covering areas, not covering mans.
Third down, five. To the sidelines, dropped. Gorgeous pass. Diallo Johnson, the intended receiver.
There was good coverage, though, even, Rich. Like I said, the Rice secondary is playing very well, and they're giving their offense all the opportunities in the world, but the secondary here in the little out route, he's covered. That was a nice throw by Brady there. Nice throw and catch. Ball should have been caught.
Brady showing some frustration. And Rice on the return, Jason Hebert. First punt by Corey Sargent of the day, 37 yards. Rice has pretty good field position now, Gino, as they'll mark this ball at the Owls' 47-yard line.
And something they haven't had today, look for Rice only averaging 2.7 yards on first down. They have to pick that up in order to score some points in the second half.
Now, Tyler behind Richardson. And again, he doesn't pitch, and hello, Tommy Hendricks.
Quarterback Chad Richardson kept the ball.
He had 10 tackles against Notre Dame. He's the leader of that defense, especially in the secondary.
You'll see penetration on the left side of the line here. That voids the pitch by Richardson. Penetration kills an option, as Don McPherson told us earlier in the game. And until they stop the penetration, they're not going to have a lot of success running with the football.
Eisenhower High School in Houston, and obviously Rice in Houston. Hendricks was very anxious to see the Rice Owls today. Inside handoff going nowhere. Tahani Jones and Grady Brooks made the stop on Anthony Griffin, not to be confused with Archie. Don't look at Griffin. And all of a sudden the field position is backed up a bit. Rice at their own 39, faced with third down and a bunch, 18. Richardson had lots of time, tucks it under, loose football.
That is Michigan, not a fumble.
Who's got, they'll say Michigan has it. Josh Williams, another Houston kid, forced the fumble.
That was the ground. Richardson was reaching the ball out to get a few extra yards of field position for his punt team. Look to me that the ground caused that fumble.
Michigan received a huge break in the first half on a non-call on what was a Michigan fumble. Well, I don't know, Gino.
That one may have been a fumble.
All right. I was waiting for that. I was waiting for that. It looks like the proper call. Brady, a quick throw. Terrell fighting to get the 10 yards, and he's very close. Josh McMillan made the stop. Let's take a look and see if the knee comes down before the ball pops loose.
Hey, Richardson faked the option, drops back. No one's open. He's got all the time in the world. Trying to get a few extra yards for his punt team. And Williams, you can't really tell from that angle. But I think the umpire's right on top of it. He made a good call if he called a fumble.
Brady, lots of time, going deep. Terrell, no. Josh McMillan, the coverage. Not a bad throw, though.
You know what, Rich? With the switching of quarterbacks between Brady and Henson, Brady may be trying to force things, trying to go deep, trying to make big plays in order to force Lloyd Carr for him to be the starter the rest of the season.
When I asked Lloyd Carr yesterday, how do you avoid a quarterback controversy? He said, you know what? This is tougher on the quarterbacks than it is on me, the head coach.
Well, as the head coach, he's got two players that he knows can play. Brady won the Big Ten for him last year. It's a 10-3 record, 11-3 record now as a starter. Henson's got all the talent in the world, could be one of the best to ever come out of Michigan. So I think for him, it's a great situation to be in. But as a player, either one of these guys has the talent to lead this football team. You know, just see how it plays out the rest of the season for Michigan.
Brady, it's deflected and loose and incomplete. Wesley Kubish made the deflection. Dan Dawson in there as well. Dawson sticks his nose in just about everything.
Dawson coming off the edge there, trying to get some good pressure. And Coach Hinshaw, the defensive coordinator for Rice, said he would pick and choose his spots to bring pressure to Brady or Henson. And Michigan, he just really hasn't had that much opportunity because Michigan's making some big plays and keeping Rice on their heels defensively.
On second and 10. Complete at the 24-yard line. Diallo Johnson held on to that one.
Rich, both Brady and Henson have very strong arms. That throw right there, 10-yard out cut, is one of the hardest throws in football. It's a quick five-step drop, plant and throw the ball. You'll see him puts the ball right on the money, right on the sidelines. A tough throw. This is going to be a tough call for Lloyd Carr.
And this is exactly why Lloyd Carr was unable to make a decision during the preseason practices, because they both played exceptionally well in 2 days leading up to the opener against Notre Dame. Anthony Thomas with the carry.
Then it comes down to who plays better in the games. Well, what if they both play great? Does he keep doing the second quarter with Henson, fourth quarter with Henson? Brady starts, plays third quarter.
I got the sense that he wanted to have a decision by the time the Big Ten schedule comes around in 2 weeks.
I believe so, because I think you want your team to rally around one quarterback. Who that'll be, we don't know.
Thomas to the 16. The danger is, what if the quarterback that Carr chooses is not the quarterback the team wants?
Well, then you may have some animosity, but I don't think that's going to happen. I think Lloyd Carr's prepared his team to whatever quarterback he chooses to start. The team is going to rally around him. They're set everywhere else offensively. Their offensive line, the running back, and Thomas, Terrell, the wideout, and Knight, they're set everywhere else. So either one of these guys pulling the trigger is going to get the job done for him.
Thomas has the first down. Down to the 11. It doesn't hurt that both quarterbacks can turn around and give the football to that man, Anthony Thomas.
It doesn't hurt at all. Anytime you have a running back like Thomas, he's one of the premier backs in the country. Just a simple little toss, makes one guy miss, steps up inside and gets the first down. That right there shows he's not only fast, but he's tough. He can take a beating, and he will turn upfield and run after a DB and run him over.
Just a junior, 138 yards. Last week, he's at 72 yards this week, and he's got a big hole on the left side. Thomas is in. Touchdown, Michigan.
The Rice out defense has got to be getting tired here, Rich. I think that was a very impressive drive by Michigan, but it all comes down to the front fours of both teams, the size of Michigan versus the lack thereof size of Rice's front four.
Jeff Del Verne for the extra point. And Michigan adds to the lead. Lloyd Carr's team rolling today against Rice, 27 to nothing. Number 5 Michigan on top. How do you like your Richardson? The pitch is to Gingrich, and he goes down. Dwayne Patman. One thing Jim Herman, the defensive coordinator of Michigan, has, Geno, his first 3 games this year are against teams that run some sort of an option.
That will help them in the first 3 games. You see Richardson come down the line. This is where the speed of Michigan's defense just outmatches Rice.
Notre Dame last week, the triple option here with Rice, and then Syracuse next week. The following week, there's no option involved. It's Rod Dane in Wisconsin. Richardson throws it away after he was hit. Rob Remus,
I think they're back, Rich,
will get credit for a sack. Flag down in the defensive secondary.
The bad part about this option offense is when you do try to throw the football, you only have one wide receiver in the game. So Michigan, they only need to cover one person as opposed to a tight end and 2 wide receivers and maybe one of the backs out of the backfield. That's why they can't throw the ball very successfully. With only one wide receiver on the field, you don't have many options of where places to go with the football.
Defensive holding, that one wide receiver was held.
Preliminary indication of a holding penalty against Michigan.
Richardson has good time here to sit in the pocket, but with only one option, he turns it and he's basically staring at one choice, and the secondary is going to key his eyes.
You could see the holding. James Whitley, the junior corner, had a hold of Richardson's receiver. There's Jim Herman, the defensive coordinator, third year as the defensive coordinator here, his 10th year at Michigan.
Winner of the 1997 Frank Broyles Award for top assistant coach in college football when they won the national championship.
And his Michigan defense has performed very well today against this triple option. Richardson will keep it to the 42. 27-0, Michigan on top. Next week's it's Syracuse. They run an option, not like this. Don McPherson's down below. Donnie, what are some of the differences Michigan's going to face defensively against Syracuse's option?
Well, the one thing they're going to see right away is they're going to see a much bigger, much faster offensive unit than Rice, and they'll see a different kind of offense as well. It won't be straight wishbone offense or veer option. What they'll see is more straight drop back, a multiple set offense, very few plays, but multiple sets and a lot more passing.
When Lloyd Carr saw Don McPherson in our meetings yesterday, he quickly arranged for a police escort out of Schembechler Hall. He didn't want any secrets going over to Syracuse.
No passing along of the secrets to the Orangemen before their big game next week.
Actually, it was all in good fun. Carr was very, very candid with us yesterday. And in a very good mood, as you would expect, coming off that huge win over Notre Dame.
Rich, I don't know if he's going to be very happy with his team's performance, though, after this game. The first half, he wanted to be more effective in the red zone. The first half, they had an opportunity to score 35 points, only scored 20. When they outmatch an opponent like this versus Rice, I think they have to be more efficient scoring touchdowns as opposed to field goals inside the red zone.
Rice is just 1 of 8 on third down. Richardson running out of time, and down he goes, and Raiders got him again. This time there's no flag. This time the captain of the Michigan defense gets his sack.
Another coverage sack there. Richardson drops back, has all the time in the world. Whitley on the coverage. With only one wide receiver to throw to, and if he's covered, the option offense is dead. And Rennes picks up a nice coverage sack there.
Rice's game just 32 carries today. Travis Hale to punt it away, and it's blocked. And loose. And picked up. Marquise Walker blocked it. Michigan will have it at the 4-yard line.
Rich, I just talked about Lloyd Carr maybe not being too happy with his team's performance, but this will put a smile on his face. When you get the three phases of the football game, offense, defense, and special teams, your special teams has to make key plays in big football games. And I think last week with Epstein kicking the ball off, having 5 touchbacks out of 7 kickoffs was huge field position for them versus Notre Dame. Here you see a block punt. Big play, big plays all around.
Brandon Williams picked it up, and it was Walker who gets the block. Tom Brady to Thomas, touchdown. Anthony Thomas, his second touchdown. Del Verne.
Kick is good.
Knocks it through. Hail, hail, indeed. Anthony Thomas and Michigan up big. Drew Henson is back in. as a throw to Aaron Shea, the big fullback, who may be a tight end at the next level. He's an excellent pass receiver, and at 6'5", 251, he has tight end size and speed.
The thing I like about that play, though, Henson sees the pressure. Rice comes up in a blitz, finds the open man, and Shea wasn't covered in the flat. Big completion there on a little short pass.
B.J. Askew getting the carry for Michigan, and Askew is inside the 40, down to the 37-yard line. 13 yards on the pickup. Travis Ortega with the stop.
B.J. Askew.
I think the Rice-Owl defense is just wore out right now. They're used to playing 15 to 20 minutes of ball game with the offense of Rice. If they can control it 35 to 40 minutes a game, the other team only has 20 minutes to be on the field. That's not happening today.
Henson on first and 10. Askew, big hit by Joe Bob Thompson. But Askew bounced right off of him. Abear and Ortega finally made the stop. There's Joe Bob. Sophomore out of Dangerfield, Texas. One of the tough things for Rice defensively is your time of possession.
They lead in time of possession, but that is not their goal. Was 35 to 40 minutes this game, and they don't have enough time left to make that up, especially 34 points.
Second down and 10. Henson to the air for the sidelines, and it's incomplete. Don't feel too sorry for defensive coordinators that have to prepare for the Rice offense. You should feel sorry for the defensive coordinator for Rice, Roger Hinshaw, because simulating other teams' offenses are very difficult for Rice. They don't have the personnel to say simulate what a Michigan does offensively. They don't have a drop-back quarterback in their program, and it's difficult to simulate the speed, the quickness, and the accuracy of a quarterback week in and week out. Caught by Marquise Walker. Flag goes down. And possibly a late hit.
It's very difficult for Rice to simulate a Michigan offense because in their offense, they essentially have four running backs in the backfield. Just Richardson or the quarterback, whoever it is, or Evans, they could throw the ball. They really have four tailbacks in the backfield in the game at all times. So to simulate a passing attack like Michigan, very, very tough.
The flag is on Kenny Smith, it looks like. There's the catch by Walker. Wasn't much of a late hit. I mean, it was late, but it wasn't much of a hit.
It looked like Kenny Smith tried to pull back. Receiver tries to come back into the end. I don't know. I think in a ball game like this, 34 to nothing, I think a no call is a good call.
First and 10,
is this the last series for Henson? On the pitch, it's Askew. And he's down to the 12.
I think so. I think you give both your starters, if we can call them both starters, Brady and Henson, a chance to come out. They drive right down the field. If Henson has a chance to score, it'll be 41-0 going into the fourth quarter. You have to start getting your backups playing time because depth at top schools is the reason these schools are the tops in the country, because their backups are almost as good as their starters.
Second and 6. Askew again. This time he's tripped up. Rashard Pittman.
35 made the stop. Tackled by Jason Hebert. Rashard Pittman. Attention, please. Rick.
Take your pick.
And Craig Miller.
Brady's numbers look more impressive, but I think the offense when Henson was in there was a little bit more settled and moved the ball. They didn't have a lot of penalties against them. But really, both of them have been very effective. That's a tough decision for Coach Carr.
Askew to the 14. Pittman made the stop again. And that will be the final snap of the third quarter.
On the 18-yard line, it's fourth down 7.
Michigan, number five in the country, and playing like it today, on top of Rice, 34-0. Jeff Delvern on for the field goal attempt at 30 yards. He's hit twice today, 24 and 38. Add that one to the books. This kid who got the scholarship on Monday, Lloyd Carr said he walked on. He had a chance to go to other schools, but he wanted to kick at Michigan. So he walks on. He makes the team. He hits four field goals against Notre Dame. And on Monday, much to the delight of the entire team, he gets his scholarship. He's a very popular guy amongst the team. One of the reasons why, he is a great imitator of men. He does a dead on Lloyd Carr.
And it's not behind his back. Lloyd has seen it.
Yeah. College football tonight on the deuce, South Carolina against number 12 Georgia. That's at 5 Eastern. Lou Holtz back in action. And then number 23 Texas against Rutgers. That's at 8 Eastern tonight on the deuce. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network. Go.com. There's Delvern. The players we talked to said he does a great Lloyd Carr. We asked him if he did Bo Schembechler, and they looked at each other and said, no one would dare imitate Bo Schembechler.
He is the
that one's off
legend.
Limits.
The living legend here in Michigan. And can you blame him not wanting to come here and kick the football? This is a great place, great school, fun atmosphere.
Phil Brabs getting a chance to kick the football. Sean White out to the 25-yard line.
Take about number 25, Sean White.
Rich, I don't know if I necessarily agree with Lloyd Carr to kick the field goal on that last drive. I mean, Rice has only been able to put up 63 yards of total offense. Can that be classified as running up the score or no?
No, it's 3 points. I think you still have to play the game in the context of field position.
Number 5, Chad Richardson, backup quarterback for Rice.
Of course, you mix in a few BCS formulas, and 3 points doesn't hurt. So I don't think it helps you that much in the big picture. Now, had he gone for it on fourth down, Gino, I think we would have cause for alarm. How's that?
I think you can look at it both ways, to tell you the truth. I really do.
We can agree to disagree, Gino.
But I think with the BCS, I really didn't think about that. I think the margin of victory comes into play towards the end of the season. If it comes down between them and another team in the top five or top two, maybe that's why he went for the field goal there.
Jamie Tyler. I think also he wants Delvern to keep getting experience. He likes the fact that Delvern is now 7 of 8 on the season as a kicker. Richardson back in the ball game, and he's out across the 35 to the 36-yard line. James Whitley made the stop. Let's head to the studio. Reese Davis. Reese.
Rich, you would think there would be little reason to care about the Angels and Twins, but Eric Melton throws a no-hitter. Strikeouts and the no-hitter in this one. And Sammy Sosa wondering if he can hit 60. Not yet. He's 1 for 2 with a single, still sitting on 59, trying to become the second guy to have 2 60 home run seasons.
Thanks, Reese. 37-0 here. Richardson's throw is a wobbler, and it's picked off. Cato June. And June is down to the 17-yard line. Everyone getting in on the act right now for the Wolverines.
Cato June, just a situation being in the right place at the right time. Richardson drops back to pass, gets pressure, gets hit as he delivers the football by Petrozello. This is just the talent and the depth that the Michigan defense has. They have the depth to put their backups in and still get pressure on the quarterback. This is why the University of Michigan is a top five ball club, is because of the depth and because of the top level of skill.
Dave Petrozello. On the carry for Michigan, Walter Cross. Drew Henson still in the ball game. You saw the note that Eric Milton has thrown a no-hitter for the Twins. You're looking at what many people feel is the future third baseman for the Yankees. You know, not to be outdone, Tom Brady was a catcher in high school. He was an 18th round pick by the Montreal Expos. Cross to the 16.
That's why I think it's such a big decision and a tough decision by Lloyd Carr. Both of these players are great athletes, great competitors, and I don't think they're going to lose either way, depending on what decision Lloyd makes on who's going to start for this ball club. I think they're confident in Brady. They won the Big Ten last year with him, but I think they realize the ability of Henson, how young he is, and how much better he can become over the years.
Next 2 weeks are big ones.
Back at the 17, third and 10.
For this Michigan team. Henson. Onto the outside. Kirk Mondras. To the 6-yard line.
Pass is complete. Henson to Kirk Mondras, number 49.
Another good decision by Henson there, Rich. Rice brings the pressure, voids the zone, not necessarily playing man coverage behind the blitz, playing zone. Henson takes advantage of it and hits the fullback out of the backfield.
Gino, here's the situation we were talking about. Now, it's fourth down and short. Michigan, I don't believe, is running at it by going for it here. They're staying within the context of the game. Henson straight ahead.
True, I just didn't think on the last drive, I don't think 3 points is going to make a difference either way. That's why I just threw that out, because I know how the media likes to put pressure on coaches. Hey, are they running up the score? But with BCS, with the score and the differential, the amount of points you score every week, that becomes a factor. Every one of these little field goals towards the end of the game, you get into tight ball games.
Gino, I think if you ask coaches throughout the country last year and even this year, if 3 points works in the BCS, they might scratch their head and say, I don't know, because that BCS formula is, they're still trying to figure that out, most of the coaches.
They are.
And broadcasters.
It's early to talk about that, but, you know, if points comes into play, Carr has to be thinking, hey, we scored 3 more points here. You know, it bodes well for our team later on this season. If we get some 10-3 ball games or 10-7 ball games that the Big Ten is traditionally known for having, not high scoring contest.
Tad Van Pelt watches it land out of bounds. The Rice Owls struggling with the Wolverines. That, my friends, is an underscore
reps. He's comfortable with the experience factor of Brady, but I think he's just trying to get Henson a few more snaps, a few different looks at the defense, maybe run a few special situational plays.
Not many of those 110,000 have headed for the exits. Charles Drake made the stop. Let's head back to the studios and Reese Davis. Reese?
All right, Rich. In Happy Valley, it was tied at 10 early in the fourth quarter. Penn State doing it on the ground. Eric McCoo dancing in there from the 7. The team swapped interceptions. Nigel Neal of Pitt made a great one to snuff out a Penn State drive deep in Pittsburgh territory. That game, 17-10. In West Virginia, Miami, Travis Prentice has just scored. Redhawks hanging around down 8.
Travis Prentice is a very good running back. A floater that is incomplete. Ronald Bellamy was the intended receiver.
Henson rushed that pass a little bit. He had his receiver wide open, had all the time in the world. As a quarterback, when you drop back and you see coverage break down like this and you know your receiver is going to be wide open, those are almost the tougher throws, because then you try to aim it and throw it in a perfect spot because you know your receiver is going to be wide open. I think that's what Henson did there.
Another quick kick. It's the second quick kick we've seen Henson pull off. This one not nearly as successful.
Looked like it was blocked there, Rich.
As the first. We'll take a timeout. Michigan on top of Rice. Back after this. Jason Kapsner is in at quarterback, and he lights it up. A catch, a sliding catch at the 18-yard line by Tyrese Butler. The officials, though, are going to come and wave it off. The offside official came from across the field to say that Butler dropped the ball. Kapsner's not happy about it.
This is a tough throw to come from the sidelines. You haven't played all day and throw what you call a bang eight, a tough post route. You have to throw it in between linebackers, and you have to perfect throw that. You have to throw that perfect. You have to lead your guy and throw it over the linebacker. Tough throw to come off the bench and throw that first pass.
Looked like a tremendous catch. Kapsner on the draw. B.J. Askew.
All carried by B.J. Askew.
To the 28-yard line. So Kapsner takes over on a day where we saw Tom Brady and Drew Henson both play. Quick throw and a catch. And drop.
Kapsner's pass intended for Askew, incomplete.
Askew, the intended receiver.
Josh McMillan defending.
It's disappointing for Michigan because I think Brady and Henson, they want Kapsner to get in there and get some playing time, make some first downs. And I think Boykar does it. The kid's a senior, he's been here 5 years. It's always good as a starting quarterback when you let the backup play and get a lot of yards.
Rice just ran into the punter.
So he'll have another chance.
Corey Sargent went down. And the return is out to the 29-yard line.
Do the option if you can get on the outside and force the defender's hand. Will you have the option to pitch off one of their defenders? And Rice with the penetration.
Number 8, Wisconsin. Number 16, Purdue comes in. And then Michigan State on the road.
And what does Michigan do with their quarterback situation after that game at Syracuse? Does Lloyd Carr decide to go with Henson or Brady? Or does he keep the rotation going?
It's hard at the start and it's difficult at the end with Penn State and Ohio State on that schedule. I don't know. I mean, it'll be interesting to see what happens next week at Syracuse as well. Evans looks pretty good running this option. And he's down to the 20-yard line.
Corey Evans.
The thing you got to like about Rice is they haven't given up. Even though they're down 37 points and they're going to lose this football game, Evans is coming out and trying to make some big plays for his team. And that is the sign of a well-coached team.
This Michigan crowd, this Michigan team does not want Rice in the end zone. And Evans fumbles the snap and falls on it.
Fumble on the snap covered by the quarterback, Corey Evans.
Rich, going back to Henson and Brady, I don't think it's a bad call either. Either way, however, Lloyd Carr, I think both of them are very good players. Henson accounted for 20 points today. Brady accounted for 17. It's really a toss-up. I think they both played well. I think it showed, he told us the competition was very close in the summer. Last spring it was very close. And even in games it's very close. Maybe they keep doing the rotations the rest of the season.
37-0, Michigan on top. The season premiere of ESPN Sunday Night.
Down to resist, so like I said, I don't think it's a bad situation either way, depending on which quarterback they go to or decide to keep rotating quarterbacks.
Evans to the 17-yard line.
Quarterback Corey Evans carry. Tackled by Dave Shansky. Andy now at the 16.
And the Rice Owls are going to try to break the shutout. They're going to try to get on the board and kick a field goal. Derek Crabtree, their field goal kicker, is on. 33 yards on the attempt. This is his first attempt this year. And he got it.
The kick is good. Michigan 37, Rice 3.
Crabtree, the sophomore out of Duncanville, Texas, gives Rice its first 3 points of the ball game.
And Evans has come in and showed he can make plays. That's why Coach Hatfield was so excited about getting him into the ball game. I think he wishes it would have been under a little bit different circumstances than it happened today. But as we go through the season and as Rice goes through the season, do they look to play Evans more?
Now, wait a minute. You're trying to start another quarterback situation on a totally different campus. Bellamy Bellamy is out to the 24-yard line. Tough day for both those gentlemen. Chad Richardson, the starting quarterback, the man in the red shirt, David Lee, the offensive coordinator for the Owls. Final snap. Some spirited running by Charles Drake. Joe Bob Thompson made the stop. Lloyd Carr still coaching him. Number five, Michigan, has hammered Rice. 37-3, the final score for our entire ESPN 2 crew. For Don McPherson and Gino Toretta, I'm Rich Waltz. We'll send you to college football today after another great moment from ESPN's past 20 years. Good